Our topic today is transportation problem, and we are going to take it into at least two classes. Okay. It's an interesting topic, and we will learn how to solve problems manually. So today we'll try to understand what transportation problem is and how to formulate the model, what are the parameters required, what are the variables, how to frame the problem, and prepare the linear programming model. Okay, so we have four tasks to complete today. The first is the history, to know how did it start, the who started, who formulated first the transportation problem, why. So just a brief history. But if you wish, you can read as much as possible regarding the development, because it's interesting to know how the tools have been developed. The second is, you know, we'll understand about the network flow problems, and we'll learn that in fact the transportation problem and the other two types of problems are collectively called network flow problems. Like in the linear programming, we will see that there are different types of problems which are solved using the linear programming modeling. One is product mix. Similarly, network flow problem is also a linear programming problem, but it's of a special type where networking is there, where the movement of goods take place in the form of a network. Okay, so that's what we have to learn, and then we will see what are the three types of problems covered under the network flow. And finally, for today, you know, we'll understand the first type of network flow problem, that is the transportation problem. The other two we'll take in the next class, inshallah, with the transshipment and assignment problem. And also we'll try to also complete the problem solving in the next class if possible, because that may take time. Okay, so we'll not rush, we'll just try to make it as reasonable as possible. So let us start with this interesting topic. Today it will be more regarding the theoretical parts and the modeling, and the solution will be left for the next class. Yeah, in the textbook, you know, I am using the entire contents from the textbook. So if you would like to read the contents in the text, so you can refer to the pages 233 to 252. Okay, and there you can find this topic: transportation, transshipment, and network flow problems. Okay, so the first point to be understood is, how did it start, who started, who formulated the transportation problem. So there are two main people, main researchers or scholars who formulated and developed the transportation method for solving a special type of problems where, you know, transportation was required. So the first person, as we can see, you know, his name is number A, is Frank L. Hitchcock, He was a mathematician, and in 1941 he was the first person to develop and formulate the transportation problem, because you know there was a problem how to supply products from several factories to a number of cities. So that became a challenge, you know. And thing is, you know, the same product, because you have so many factories and there are so many markets, so obviously the cost of transportation will be different from one city to the other. So that was a problem to be solved, and means they needed, you know, it was a need to have some model, some tool to easily solve this problem so that the cost is minimized. And Frank L. Hitchcock, he first formulated it. In fact, it's written, you know, I have just taken a part about the history from the book, but if you read, it's written that even though transportation method belongs to the family of linear programming problem, it was developed before the linear programming was formally established by George Dantzig, right? So in 1941, for the first time, transportation problem was formulated by Frank L. Hitchcock. Then in 1947, another economist who was basically from Netherlands, but then he shifted to USA and taught at universities of Chicago and Yale. His name was T.C. Koopmans. So in 1947, he carried on with the transportation problem, and finally, you know, he made it a very formal and tested it in several circumstances and found that it is a good model to solve the problem of transportation. For this, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1975. And you can understand that Nobel Prize is awarded to the best inventions or discoveries in the field. So in economics and maths, you know, you'll have to check. I don't remember, you know, he got it for mathematics, perhaps, or economics. But, you know, it was a very important contribution to industry as well as the government, because this is a challenge even for the government, because, you know, the governments are responsible for distributing essential items like rice, wheat, essential items which are given, which are produced and distributed. So there are many products which are distributed by the government, like petrol, gas, etc. So, you know, that's a problem which needed to be solved, and this transportation method offered a very good tool to solve that problem. And the main challenge here, means the main problem for the manager, was to decide on the best route of transportation to minimize the transportation cost. Okay. All right. So that's a little brief about the history of transportation and network flow problems. And also we have understood, just introduced, that this is a type of linear programming model. Okay, it belongs to the same model, linear programming, and this linear programming we'll take in after we complete transportation. Linear programming is the broad family. It's a linear programming means simply, as we discussed in the last class, if we say in a very simplistic form, linear programming means when the variables can be arranged in a when we plot the variables on a graph, we get a straight line which shows the relationship between the variables. Only then, you know, linear programming can be applied. This will be called a linear programming solution. or a linear programming problem. This linear programming problem can be of different types. So transportation or network flow is one, product mix problems are there, and many are there. So we'll see in the chapter on linear programming in detail how many types of problems are there. But network flow problems are a special types of linear programming model or linear programming problems, in which we need to discuss transportation problem, transshipment problem, and assignment problem. So there are three types of network flow problems which fall under the category of the network flow problems, which have three categories: the transportation, transshipment, and assignment. And broadly, they belong to the family of linear programming. So they are, you know, part of a larger class of linear programming problems known as network flow problems. So we'll see very shortly, you know, after a few minutes, why we call it network flow problems. Okay, before I move forward, just let me check if you are with me. So who got the Nobel Prize for transportation problem? Was it Hitchcock or Koopmans? And you have to answer on WhatsApp group, because, you know, I want to check as I move forward. I need to check, means you are with me. So who got the Nobel Prize? Was it Hitchcock or Koopmans? Somebody is typing. Do it fast. You are checking slide, huh? Okay. Do it fast, please. So you can speak. Okay. So let's complete the history part. You were with me. There are two main people, main scholars who contributed to the development of transportation method. One was Frank Hitchcock, and the other was T.C. Koopmans. So who got the Nobel Prize for developing this model, transportation method, or network flow problem? No. So it was Koopmans, okay? It was Koopmans who got the Nobel Prize. Okay, let's move forward. Please be with me, okay? Please pay attention and be awake. So let's discuss the first type of the network flow problem, that is transportation problem, and be attentive. Now here, you know, in all the three, when we say transportation or movement of goods in business, that means it has to do something with the cost. I mean, there is no income in this. The only way a company makes income is through sales, right? By selling products. All others are cost center. So this is also, the transportation is one of the major components of the cost of production. And even if it is less, it has to be, cost has to be controlled, cost has to be minimized as much as possible. Especially, you know, if it is possible, it's very much possible to minimize the cost, then, you know, the manager has to decide, the business enterprise must do anything to minimize the cost. So we understand that this problem of transportation is about minimizing the cost. That is the objective function. And the second point regarding transportation problem is that There are several sources, there are several supply centers, and there are several receiving centers. Meaning, there are places of production, point of production, or you know where the goods are produced, the factories, the same product, but it cannot be produced in one factory, so the companies do need more than one plants or facilities to produce the same product, and these products are supposed to be sent to different markets. So the same product, there are different markets, it may be any product. So when there are same products being sent from various factories to various markets, which are called sources and destinations, then you know the question arises, how to send, right? So how to send means what should be the proper route, what should be the proper route or path to send the products from one factory to the market. So that's a decision that has to be taken, and that contributes to the total cost of transportation. So if we do it properly, we can minimize the cost. If we do it with some good tool, good technique, then we can minimize the cost. So that's the second point. The first is in the transportation problem, cost minimization is done. Then there are supply centers and there are cost centers, the receiving centers or markets. Each source has a certain supply and each source has a certain demand. That means the supply side and demand side both are limited. It cannot be unlimited. So, and that's the reason why the company has so many factories or so many plants, because you know they cannot manage everything from one factory or warehouse. So they need many, more than one. 1, 2, 3 are required to manage the demand. And on the demand side also, if they have more than one market, so each of the markets have a limited demand. So this is another feature of the transportation problem, that both on the supply side and demand side, there are some limits. There are limits. And a very interesting example or very relevant example will be, you know, the vaccine distribution right now. I mean, it's being required in bulk, and there are few companies who are producing, who have got the license to produce, but if the demand is so huge that they cannot produce indefinitely or in a very unlimited quantity, so what they have done, you know, they will fix some quotas. They will fix some quota. They will decide, okay, we are going to send to country wise, and this country we can produce 1 million doses. So out of the 1 million doses, you know, we are going to send 50% to this country, 20 to this, 10 to this, and this way, you know. So in any case, there are two reasons why demand may be limited. One, you know, the company fixes the demand, which is called quota, or the number of customers are limited, the natural, you know, limit, that there are only few customers in every market and they need only this much. So based on the demand side, we have to decide how many products we should send to the particular market. Then the last point regarding the transportation problem, last feature regarding the transportation problem, is that the cost of shipping. Shipping is another word for transportation. From a source to a destination is directly proportional to the number of units shipped. So that means, you know, the if we have, say, you know, three factories, three supply centers, and there are three markets, the cost and the product is the same. Product is the same that we that is to be sent. In market 1, 2, 3, the same products are to be sent, which are produced at S1, S2, S3. So we have many choices. Now the question arises, how to send? Should I send it from S1 to M1 or S1 to M2 or S1 to M3? These are the choices available. I can send from any factory to any market. There is no restriction. It can be easily sent. But my target is to minimize the cost. So that's the major, you know, objective. And based on that, you know, we have to decide. So this tool will help us in deciding the best route. This is the main task, a main challenge to solve in this problem. The best route to send the products from one factory to the market in order to minimize the cost. Best route means minimum cost. Okay, so here it's clear till so far. Okay, yeah, it depends upon the demand. And you understood why demands, sometimes we know that there are, like in vaccine case, why is, how much is the demand? Demand is unlimited. I mean, the target for vaccine, you are understanding corona vaccine, the COVID vaccine will be required to be at least given to 75% of the world population. That's what the target is, you know, 75%. That means, and how much is the capacity of a company like Pfizer or Moderna or any company? There are handful, 10-15 companies who are, even in Saudi, you know, they are now trying to produce. But no matter how hard we try, the capacity will still be limited. So that means it's a unique situation. The demand is very huge, but the production is less. So what happens again? So can we send unlimited demand? I mean, how to model that problem? Then in that case, the company will limit the demand, will decide we are going to send 100 to this country, 100 to this country, 100 to this country. So this will be the limit set by the company itself because of the limited capacity. So that is called quota. The other scenario is that there is a limited demand, as Murud just said, depending upon the demand. So demand is, for example, you know, how the cars, aeroplanes, you know, aircrafts, all of these are, you know, have limited demand. So the, if Boeing or Airbus will try to sell to countries and distribute, they know, you know, in 6 months or 3 months they will get one order, and that will take 1 year to produce or 6 months to produce. So it may be from the demand side also, natural restriction. So what did we understand in transportation problem? What are the main features? What, because, you know, we have to follow the same steps as we learned in the management science problem solving. What are the steps? Observation, then problem solving, problem definition. Then what we do? What is the third step? Modeling. Very good. So good, Muruj. So the third is modeling. And then, you know, once we have created the model, that means all the factors, variables, parameters, constraints have been put in place, then, you know, we can apply the method. We are going to apply transportation method. There are several methods to solve transportation problem that we are going to learn in the next class. And only we can do that, we can do that only when we have modeled it properly. So what are the factors we are seeing? The cost is the objective, sources and destinations are the supply and demand. The constraint is that it's limited on both sides, both supply and demand, and the factor which affect the main factor that would affect the cost is the transportation cost for moving the products from one center to the other center. Okay, so let's move forward. All of you are with me, understood? Wake up, okay, and just be attentive. It's interesting, very interesting. Okay, now the same problem we can easily, okay, thank you Asrar, Shahed and Fauzia and Asrar and R, good. So you have to keep, you know, answering. I'm teaching boys in the evening, 3 days, and yesterday I had to tell them that if you wish I can just send you recordings, because the students have to keep alive, you know, keep themselves alive on WhatsApp group, so that the teacher is knowing that you are there. Otherwise, I have to tell them. I told them I will send you recordings, I will give you a quiz for every chapter if you wish that way. Because in online class, you know, it's very difficult to handle, okay? So, no, not for you, for them. Because, you know, there nobody responds. You know, I ask a question and then I just keep waiting. So after 2-3 minutes, I then say, okay, let's move forward. So, okay, anyway. So, the simple, and that's evening. So evening, I know there are many people are working, so it's difficult for them. Simple network representation. So what we see here, that once we have created a picture for the problem, we can easily see that a network type of a structure has been formed. And what we are seeing, that there are supply centers and there are demand centers. We have S1, S2, SM, yani it can go 1, 2 till M, and D1, D2 till N, yani these are endless. M can be any number, it can be 1000, it can be 5000, or it can be 3, 4, whatever. So that's why supply centers can be from 1 to M, demand centers can be from 1 to N. Demand means market. These are the markets where consumption or the consumers are present. And here it's the factory where the production is done. The product is the same. That's the thing, you know. The product is the same, or the product mix is the same. It's also possible that this company is Pepsi and we are not distinguishing between the Diet Coke and Black Pepsi and the White Pepsi and 7-Up, etc. We, in transportation problem, the problem comes to us, we feel it as Pepsi product, it's one product, and the challenge for the supply chain manager is to move the product from one market to the other, from factory to the market, in a way that the cost is minimized. So what we see here, this is the cost, Cij. What does Ij mean? Ij means the root. So this is I and this is J. So the movement of the product from 1 to 1, 1 to 2. So 1 is the supply of Cij. So they say, or, you know, if they are saying it here, 1 and 2, so you can also say S1, D1, S1, D2, S1, D3. Okay, so let's say, you know, this is S3, this is 3, and this is 3. So we have 3 factories, S1, S2, S3, and we have 3 markets, D1, D2, D3. So what are the possible alternatives for the manager? Now you start doing some exercise. So first objective, first alternative for the manager is to the root number S1, D1, okay? So what are the other alternatives? This is first alternative. So she can send the product from factory S1 to the market D1. Okay, there will be some cost in this. Maybe this costs 10 rials. This is a very far off place, so it will cost 30 rials. We are right now considering the choices. So first is S1 Dupan to D1, and what are the other choices? Let's list them all. So S1 D1 is one, S1 D2 is second. Now you tell me, do it fast. How many choices are there? Just give me a count. Total, how many alternatives are there for the manager to decide? 3. Consider all of them. 1, 2 and 3. S1, S2, S3 and D1, D2, D3. So total, how many choices are there for D1, D2, D3? So if you look at these arrows, how many total arrows are there? These arrows are the routes and these are the alternatives. So the we call it decision alternatives. 6, only 6. We have taken this also, S3. Mruj is right. She considered these two, but we have to add one more. So if we have 3 supply centers and we have 3 demand centers, the total choice for the manager is 9. So 9 alternatives are available. 9 decision alternatives are present. And now the task is to choose. And that's what we did in the earlier classes when we were discussing the introduction and fundamentals of management science, that it helps in decision making. And what is decision making? Choosing between 2 or more alternatives. So now comes the time when management science will help the company. Asrar is right, 9. So now comes the time when the manager will be able to use management science as a quantitative technique to choose between decision alternatives. So 9 decision alternatives are there and he has to choose. But what should be the minimum number? It has to be there. It cannot be less than that. Who will tell? Think logically and tell me what will be the minimum choices. Any minimum? It can be more than that, but one minimum has to be there. Out of these 9 routes, the manager must choose at least how much? Tell me. 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. What would be the number? Or he has to choose all 9? Is there any minimum you feel logically? Tell me. Think logically. It's very interesting. Think. Is there any minimum number that has to be chosen? 1. Asrar says 1. What about others? So if suppose you know the manager chooses 1 route, he wants to send all the products from 3, Shahad, Muruj, R, Asrar, Amjad, Fauzia. And they are right, you know. Why 3? Because of the constraints, right? Because of the constraints. Because we have 3 factories, all of them are producing some number. For example, they produce 50, this produces 60, this produces 40, and here there is a demand. So here there is a demand for say 10, here there is, so how many are there? 50, 60, 150. Here there is a demand for 90 and here there is a demand for 50. Now the question is, let's say you know you are saying just 1, so in any case 1 will never be able to satisfy both sides. You know, supply side there is 60, 40 and 50, so the highest value is 60, but if we just have 60, we will not be able to meet the demands of any market. Suppose we just take one market, we are only going to supply to this one. So what about the supply side? Then we will have wastage, surplus. I mean, we have produced more and we are only supplying, suppose we send only 50 to this market. What about other 60 and 40? 100 products will be wasted. So because of the constraints on both sides, the manager has to choose minimum 3. It can be more than 3, it's possible, you know, more than 3 are there, because how will it be possible, that we will see later. But minimum 3 has to be there so that, you know, the constraints are satisfied. Okay, so I mean, we are now in a better position to understand the problem in a better way. So we'll take up an example from the book, which is on page number 234, and it's an interesting example, easy, very simple example. Our target is to basically model this and make the equation ready so that we can solve it. So what is the problem? You know, the problem is regarding product here is wheat. Let me change the color of the product is wheat, and it's produced in the Midwest, and the supply centers are 3, Kansas City, Omaha, and Des Moines. So it doesn't matter for management science people, you know, we don't care. For us, the problem is to be formulated in the model. So for us, you know, it's S1, S2, and S3. These are the 3 supply centers. These grain elevators, these are the grain elevators or suppliers. These grain elevators supply 3 flour mills located in Chicago, St. Louis, and Cincinnati. So there are 3 markets. So we can say demand center, T1, D2, and D3. We just discussed the same problem. Now grain is shipped to the mills in railroad cars, each car capable of holding 1 ton of wheat, and each grain elevator is able to supply the following number of tons. So we'll get the parameters now, okay, as we learned in our last classes when we were discussing about the modeling, model constructions, that, you know, we'll get these figures from the company or the responsible people inside the institution, who will tell us, see, this is the cost chart, these are our supply at different factories, these are the demands at different factories, and now tell me, you have to tell what should be the best route to minimize the cost. Okay, right? So that becomes the challenge, and that is where, you know, we are going to apply transportation method to solve. So we have the problem ready. We have 3 supply centers, 3 demand centers. Now let's move forward to see the details, the parameters which are given. Now let's focus, pay attention on this. So on the supply side, we call them S1, S2, S3, and demand side D1, D2, D3. On the supply side, you know, S1 can produce 150 tons. It can send 150 tons. That's the maximum capacity. S2 or Omaha City can send 175 tons, and Des Moines can send 275 tons. In total, the production or the supply capacity is 600 tons. So we have constraint number 1. We have constraint. We all know these terms now very well. Constraint number 1. So we have first constraint, which is called the supply constraint. So in that is something unique about transportation problem, that there are 2 different types of constraints. One is the supply constraint, and the other is demand constraint. And we know that in order to make a model feasible or a good model, what should be done? All the constraints have to be included in the model. If you miss any of the constraints, then the model is not correct, and if the model is not correct, the solution will be wrong. So let's look at the demand side. On the demand side, we have three demand centers. It can be more, there is no problem. It can be more, it can be less. But if it's just one, if it is just one, then you know, then network method or transportation method doesn't make much sense, because then the choices are very limited. You know, if we have just one, suppose these are three factories and there is just one demand center, only one. Here, even though you know they have, suppose D1 requires 600 and all of them together produce 150, 175 and 275. So what will happen? They have to send all of them to the demand center, whatever cost. So there is not much, you know, no optimization can be done in such a scenario. But when there is a network, when there are more than one demand centers or and more than one supply centers, then the transportation method will be applied to see what, how much can we minimize the cost, taking into account or considering the constraints. So on the demand side also, the different demand centers have different capacity. Demand center 1, Chicago, needs 200 tons, St. Louis needs 100 tons, and Cincinnati needs 300 tons. Okay, so we see that both the sides are the same. Yes, the supply and demand are equal. So that's a very important point to remember when we are modeling a problem. This is represented on the map, you can see yourself. One of the important points that we have to remember in, I'll come back to those slides, but let's finish this discussion on balanced and unbalanced problem. So in order to go ahead with the application of the transportation method, any modeling can be done, or the transportation problem can be solved, any linear programming problem or management science problem can be solved when you know the balancing has been done, you know, when the problem is balanced. If the problem is unbalanced, then the then we need to make it balanced by using some dummy variables or doing some process which cannot be done using the normal transportation method or the linear programming method to solve. So we have to first check, you know, before we are solving the problems, we need to check whether the problem is balanced or not. So in this case, is it balanced? Yes, you are understood. We have to check after we have identified the parameters, we know the supply and demand constraints, we know the that you know these are the values, these are the parameters given, and finally we add them. It's added here, but in the problems it's possible it's not added. So what we do, we will just check the total here and see if they are equal or not. If they are equal, it's good, and that's the problem, you know, we'll be getting in at our level in exam and in quizzes. I'll give you the similar problems which are balanced. You don't need to be worried, but when you solve, you must show it in your solution that you checked that the problem was balanced or not. If you don't do that, you will lose marks. Okay, so supply and demand are balanced here, equal, so the problem is balanced. Normally, you know, when we want to make it a better illustration in order to understand the problem better, we put it on the map. So this is a US map, and when we are working in any country, we would like to see how the factories and the markets are located, so that it gives a good understanding about the distance. We can easily see that Des Moines and Cincinnati is far, Des Moines and Chicago are near, Omaha is near to St. Louis and the farthest from Cincinnati. So just for getting a pictorial understanding of the distance between the cities and the transportation cost, etc., we put it on the map. Now, you know, the next parameter which is very important for solving this transportation problem, for modeling the transportation problem, is the transportation cost. Remember, this is also fixed. This is a parameter. I mean, this we cannot create our own transportation cost. We cannot do anything much, you know, in this. Okay, please leave. I'll give you the attendance. Okay. So, you know, the transportation cost will be given to us as a parameter. There will be, you know, pre-decided rates which the company has already decided with the transporter, or they have their own transporter. So the, yes, Muruji is right, the cost values are parameters. They are given to us. So for, you know, solving the problem, we need to have these values. So for a, when it comes to the management science expert, they will ask for these values. So we have to provide these values to them, and then only they can apply the transportation method and solve and tell what should be the minimum transportation cost. So these are the parameters given to us. Like, you know, if I want to, so please understand this carefully. If I want to transport, so where is the supply side? You know that, you remember, we just discussed, the supply side is here, right, S1, and these are the demand side, okay. So D1, D2, D3, and these are the supply centers, S1, S2, and S3. So if I want to, listen to my question carefully, if I want to send products from S2 to D3, and these are all 1 ton, for sending 1 ton wheat, these are the cost. So if I send my wheat from S2 to D3, how much will I have to pay per ton? Very good, 11 is the correct answer. So here, you know, we call it S2 D3 route, okay. Then similarly, you know, for all these, you know, these are the cost of transportation from this place to this place, not from this to this. The it moves here, S1 to D1, S1 to D2. So now, you know, you can easily make a chart of the various routes. 9 alternatives are there. S1 to D1 is 6, S1 to D2 is 8, S1 to D3 is 10. Now the question is, you know, what is not fixed? What can be manipulated? You know, what we can manipulate? We will call it a variable X, and this X is the number of tons, because, you know, we have the choice. Now from the 9 decision alternatives, we have the choice to choose the best route. But what is the main place where we can actually manage the cost? That is the number of tons. How many tons are we going to send from Kansas to Chicago, or from Kansas to St. Louis, or from Kansas to Cincinnati? That is what we have to find. So we need to know the value of X from this city to this city, this city to this city. I mean, it's not must that we have to send from all, but we don't know right now. That is the problem. So the X is the number of tons which can be manipulated, which can be changed, which is under the control of the manager or the to be decided, and that's the main challenge. Okay, so let's go forward and see the model. Now, you know, we are ready with all the information. We know it is a minimization problem, right? Any doubt in this? This is a minimization problem because it is dealing with, what is the main task? It's transportation cost. So it is a minimization problem. Then what are the other things given? We know already, the supply constraint and the demand constraint. So how much is the supply? In total, the supply is 600 tons from all the supply centers. And the demand is also 600 tons. So it's a balanced problem. There is nothing we have to do. We can simply model it. Now we have have to model this problem in taking into account both these constraints. So how to formulate the problem in an equation form, and then we can solve it. So when we will write the equation, we have already done, you know, the general OR model is Z min or minimize Z subject to constraints. So who will tell why there are, how many constraints are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So can you make out, you know, why 6 constraints are there? What is the reason for having 6 constraints? Let's see if you can make any guess, or you know it already. Why are there 6 constraints? These are all constraints. By looking at the numbers also you can get the idea. You can speak, no problem. Don't wait for writing. You can speak, no issues. So, did you get any idea? Yes, very good. Mashallah, good. Or I don't know what your name is, but it's perfect. She understood. So all of you can easily understand by looking at these numbers. You know, these are supply constraints. So it's 1, 2, 3 are supply constraints, and 4, 5, 6 are demand constraints. Okay, so 3 on demand side, 3 on supply side. It may differ, okay? It's, we have to remember that the constraints mainly are of two types in transportation. One is on supply and one is on demand. Now, depending on the number of supply centers and the demand centers, the number of constraints will differ. Okay, so here it's 6, 3, 3 on both sides. Now let's look at the equations. So Z, you know, minimum, what the total transportation cost will be is Z. And what is our objective? To minimize it. How much? Given these constraints, that all these constraints have to be satisfied. Only then, you know, we'll get the right, I mean, it. If we just say, you know, we are going to make, we are going to send and minimize the transportation cost to 50 or 100, that doesn't make sense. Because, you know, that's not logical. We have to make the transportation cost a minimum in a way that all these constraints are satisfied. How to calculate the transportation cost? By adding up the routes, the adding up all the possible alternatives. How many are there? These components, these factors are how many? Did you count? These are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So what are these? It's easy to understand that these are the, what are these? These are the decision alternatives. That means these are the routes. These are the choices available to the manager. Within these choices, let's take out this one and see it carefully. It says 6 multiplied by x1 and a. So what is 6? Where did we get this 6 from? This 6 is the, let's look back here. This 6 is the transportation cost of sending products from Kansas City, 1 ton of wheat from Kansas City to Chicago. And if we want to send the products from wheat from Kansas to St. Louis, 1 ton will cost 8. X is the number of ton. So here, let's go back and see here. Now this one is the cost of transportation from Kansas City to which city? Chicago. Yeah. What about x? X is the number of tons. But x number of tons, which root? 6 is for 1A. That means 1 stands for Kansas, A for, so for all the roots, we know the abbreviation 1A, 1B, 1C, 2A, 2B, 2C. Is that clear? So these are the roots proper, probable roots. One second, I'll just remove this so that you are not confused. And you can name yourself, you can just name all the roots. Okay, so this one, Des Moines, again, you tell me, this root is called 3A, this root is called 3B, and the last one is 3C. Good, very good. So you understand this. Very good. So we have all these. Now we can easily make out, you know, this is, now the only thing we have to put here is x. X is the number of tons of beet, sorry, x is the number of tons of wheat that we are going to send from one supply center to the demand center. So x, all x here, 11x, 2c, then 4x, 5x, 12x. All right, so now each component is ready, you know. So when we add them all, suppose, you know, we don't know right now, x may be 0 for many, x may be 1, 2, 3, right now when we are modeling, and that is what model is. So we are taking into account all of them, and when we add them all, we get the total transportation cost. We will get the total transportation cost. Remember, you know, don't get confused. Adding them all does not mean that all the routes are being considered, will be sent. You know, it's must that I have to send from Kansas to Chicago. This X will give us the value. You know, we will be able to select by using the transportation method when we solve in the next week. We will then decide, you know, whether we are going to send all the 150 that Kansas produces to Chicago or St. Louis or Cincinnati. So what will be the distribution of the wheat to different centers? That is what we have to solve. But in modeling, you know, we have got this Z min, the equation, that these are all the possible alternatives, and we have to consider all of them. If we are cancelling any after the solution, then, you know, we will get the minimum transportation cost. We may be able to get take all of them to minimize the transportation, or we can only take 3 to minimize the transportation. Between 3 to 9 will be our answer. You know, 3 routes to 9 routes will be our answer to minimize the cost. Okay, so this part is clear. So minimize Z is clear to all of you. Now let's come to the supply and demand constraint equation. So it's clear now. Here, you know, we are not using the transportation cost function. Why? Because here it's about the supply constraint. How many tons are available at supply center 1, supply center 2, 3, and similarly at the demand center 1, 2, 3. So X is the number of tons. So from 1A, 1B, 1C total, from 1A, 1B, 1C. Let's see here. From 1A, 1B, 1C. How many can we send maximum? What is the maximum capacity of Kansas? 150. That means it cannot be more than 150. It has to be less than 150 or equal to 150. This is the maximum 150. So we have to write that, you know, that is first constraint that at Kansas, the number of x may be any, x1a, x1b, x1c, but the limit is 150 because Kansas cannot send more than 150 units. Clear? Cost number of tons? Yes. Cost into number of tons. Good. Cost, yani the transportation cost per ton, yes, into number of tons. That's it. Number of tons into cost per ton. At the different centers, it's given. So we have to just put the values of the cost per ton and then multiply by the number. Now, the first constant of Kansas is 150. Then comes the next supply center. What is the next supply center? Can you tell me so that I don't have to go back? It's, what is the name? Des Moines, huh? The next supply center is? Omaha, okay, Omaha. So this supply center at Omaha, the choices are, three routes are available, 2A, 2B, 2C. Number of tons can be any, X is the number of tons, but what is the limit here? 175. It has to be equal to 175. This total cannot be more than 175 because that is the maximum capacity. Similarly, for the last center, the third one, X3A, X3B, and X3C, the total capacity at this center is 275. So these three constraints are for the supply. Similarly, for the demand side also, because we know that on the demand side also there is a limit at St. Louis, Cincinnati, and which was Chicago, the limit are there. So what are the limits? At Chicago, the limit is 200. At St. Louis, the limit is 100. At Cincinnati, the limit is 300. So this has to be considered. But how many at each center from X1A, X2A, X3A, they can any Cincinnati or St. Louis, Chicago, St. Louis or Cincinnati can get from Kansas, Omaha or Des Moines, any. But Chicago needs only how much? There is a limit of demand also. Chicago needs only 200. So it comes from Kansas or Omaha or Des Moines, but it cannot be more than 200. Similarly for St. Louis, the St. Louis center can get the wheat from Kansas, Omaha, Des Moines, but the limit is 100. Similarly for Cincinnati, the wheat can come from Kansas, Omaha or Des Moines, but it has to be just 300. So this way, you know, we have been able to formulate the entire problem in a linear programming equation type, and now it's ready to be solved. And last thing to notice is the value of X, number of tons. You see, number of tons cannot be less than zero, it cannot be minus. So we have to stipulate, because you know, when we put it in the computer program, or even if we are solving, when we are manually solving, no problem, we know it. We assume that the number of tons cannot be less than zero. But in computer program, it will not understand what you are saying. So we have to tell this constraint also, that X ij, any X root from any, has to be more than or equal to zero. It can be zero, okay? X can be zero, right? You understand that? X can be zero. Like for example, this one, the first route. Suppose, you know, we are not sending any item from Kansas to Chicago. All the 150 that Kansas produced sent to St. Louis and Cincinnati, okay? So this means that X can be zero. So this has to be told to the computer program that x can be 0 or more than 0. Why it can be 0, I am telling you that. So you have to understand that. Okay. So it has to be 0 or more. So that's the final equation. And now, how can we solve? Two ways. One, there are manual methods to solve, like we'll check in the next class, or maybe afterwards, after we formulate the transshipment and assignment problem. Or computer programming is there using Excel QM or Windows QM. So we are not doing that Excel. We are doing it manually, and it will be an interesting thing to see. We'll use two methods, and we'll cross-check also. But if you wish, you can use Excel and check. In Excel, you know, you will have to have that add-in called QM, and then solve it. But we'll do it manually using the methods and see what are the results. What would be the minimum transportation cost? So with this, you know, I'll record.